Hi, and welcome to Hope Chapel of Greenville, a church based upon four pillars: preaching the authority of God's Word without apology, lifting high the name of Jesus through worship, believing firmly in the power of prayer, and sharing the good news of Jesus with boldness. We hope that today's message is a point of spiritual growth for your life. And now, here is today's message.
Okay. For those that are here, we have notes for everybody. Make sure you get your notes before you come in. We're glad to have everyone here today. This is a time where we get to worship our God. Amen.
Amen.
Time where He becomes our central focus. And God is going to glorify Himself. Remember some of the aspects in the teaching of Scripture that tells us when the people of God come together, that the Spirit of God is there within us. And so expect God to move in your heart today. Expect God to present Himself to you. Expect God to say, "You're my child, and I am your God." So expect that today. Just don't hope so. Just expect that. So let's begin in a word of prayer. Ron, if you can kind of quiet people down over there, I would appreciate it. Ron, forget it. Let's just pray, and we'll pray for Ron this morning. God, as we pause before we come into your presence of song, we want to ensure that you know we love you and that we have no other God but you. And so as we bow this morning and present ourselves to you, we offer our bodies living sacrifice unto you. For this is our reasonable worship. We have nothing apart from you. We love one another and we love being here, but apart from you coming and touching our hearts and reminding us who you are, this world is a dark place. And so, God, we come asking that the Holy Spirit, whom you have promised to send and to inhabit our praises, Lord, I'm asking that each person who hears my voice right now, that they would commend their souls to you right now. And Father, teach these people, teach my heart how to worship you the way you want to be worshiped. Give grace to the worship team. Let your glory be seen in their voices and in their abilities. But God, most of all, show yourself to us, reminding us through the Holy Spirit that we are your children and you are our God. And we will bow before no other. We love you and we pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, let's worship the Lord this morning. What do you know about the glory of God? What do you personally know about the glory of God? That's been our topic from last week, and we're going to continue it today. But after that time of worship and what God has done in my heart through that time of worship, and the realization and the understanding that we have a glorious God, amen?
Amen.
And this God is not someone to play around with. This God is not someone to rebel against. This God is a great God, and He controls all of the nations of the earth. He controls who is our leaders. He controls who He brings down. He controls all of that, and it's all within His hand. And yet He comes to us today and says, "You're my people, you are my children." But I have to ask the question, how much of the glory of God do I know? How much of the glory of God is within me and is changing in me and making me a new person? And that's the question that I'm going to pose to you today. How much do you personally, principally in your soul, know about the glory of God? Or are we caught up with all of the stuff of this world, even the stuff that's at church? Because we can come to church and we can play a game too. That's what we've never wanted to do here at Hope. We have wanted to ensure the fact that every single time that you come to church and that I come to church that we sense the presence of the Almighty God. Because if that's not here, it doesn't matter who's speaking. It doesn't matter who's here. It doesn't matter how comfortable or uncomfortable you are in your seats. Because if the Spirit of God is not here, why are we? Amen? So we're going to look again at this aspect of the glory of God. And I want you to really dig into your soul. And you may have been saved for 50, 60, 70 years. I was talking to an 82-year-old man this morning. He's known the Lord all of his life. But the question I have to ask him is the same that I ask myself. How much does he, how much do you, how much do I know about the glory of God? And how poignant, how deep, how much of it is in our core? Or can we come to church wanting to praise God? Somebody says a comment to us, and all of a sudden the whole day is done. No. See, we won't be controlled by what other people say or do because we have a great God. And there's coming a day, brothers and sisters, that are here this morning that know the Lord Jesus Christ and God has changed your soul. There's coming a day where we, this group right here, will stand before this holy God who created all things and say, worship me, and we shall do so with open hearts, open hands, bowing, kneeling, saying, you are the great God. That's what I want to talk about today. We looked last week about the glory of God. And if you don't have notes, please just put your hand up and we'll make sure you get those. I'm going to give a couple of announcements a little bit later. But I want you to dig right into the scriptures. I want you to turn to Exodus chapter 19. Because we talked last week about what is the glory of God. And I want you to remember this. The glory of God is the very essence of who God is. Because God is God, therefore He's glorious. And the glory to God, is the exaltation that we bring to the table when God calls us to worship Him. And we looked at that last week, that this glory, this very issue of God's heart, it's the top number one, it's, as the theologians used to call it, it's the sine qua non of topics. It's the one without equal. It's the purpose of creation that we looked at last week. Because it says in Psalm 19:1, the heavens what? Declare the glory of God. And yet all the way through this, and this is the sad part that I've got to bring up to you, every single time God, because it's God's greatest desire, to show you His glory, because that is the greatest good. Does that make sense? If I owned a store and I wanted you to see the most greatest jewel or gem that I had in this store, I would bring you into the store, and yeah, there's hundreds or there's thousands of diamonds and thousands of jewels. And I would say, no, don't worry about all that stuff. Come over here and look at this, because this is the best. You see what I'm saying? And with God, the greatest joy and treasure of life is His own glory. So if we get caught up with anything else, regardless of what it is, we've lost it. We've gone to the second rate, see? And so God, in wanting to present Himself in His greatest joy, is to glorify Himself because He is the greatest joy. See that? For us to do that, we would say, well, the guy's proud and haughty and arrogant. But with God, it's not. It's the truth. See? So God presents Himself to us. Our response is so imperative because we are called upon then at that point when God presents Himself to us to exalt Him with our worship. So that when we worship here on Sunday morning, we're not thinking about the songs and the beauty of the music that's being played. We're thinking about our great God. See? We offer ourselves unto our great God. But all the way through history, when God came to the Garden of Eden, and last week we looked at the glory of God yesterday, and we saw there in the first point that God showed Himself in the Garden of Eden. But what happened? There was rebellion. And that began even before the Garden of Eden, because we had angels in heaven who rebelled against God, and God gave them no other chance. God did not give them a second chance. All of the angels that rebelled against God in heaven, God said, I've sealed you into the day of judgment. But with mankind, he gives second and third and fourth and fifth and tenth chances. We go to the Garden of Eden and God shares his glory. What in the Garden of Eden was not up to par? It was perfect. The whole place was wonderful. And God says, I just have one rule, one rule. That's all. Don't eat of that tree. You got these thousands of trees that you could eat all of them. Eat the bark if you'd like. Enjoy it all. Just don't touch that one. What happens? In a matter of short amount of time, both eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And God then presents to that couple his own mercy. Because he said, in the day that you eat of it, or the day that you sin, you shall surely what? Die. Now, we know physically they started to die at that point. But God had every right to take them out of existence immediately. But in his mercy to this rebellion, they repent, but they're cast out of the garden. Brothers and sisters, let me just say this. God has a garden for you to enjoy. Don't be cast out of that garden because of your love of the world. This sermon is really going to dig into your soul, and I want you to get this today. So important for you to understand that God showed his glory in the Garden of Eden, and there was rebellion. So God begins and he takes a man by the name of Abraham, and he starts an entire nation. We call it Israel. And he shows himself to this nation. They go down to Egypt. And they're down in Egypt for 450 years. And then God brings them out by the name of who? What man? Moses. He had already talked to Moses once in the burning bush. And he was showing Moses the glory that he was. And so he goes down to Egypt and he destroys the nation and he brings them out and he takes those individuals, 2.5 million of them, takes them to Mount Sinai. Now get this. And he says, I want to show this group. These guys are going to listen to me. These guys are going to hear me. And he shows his glory to this whole nation and the whole mountain, it says. I was just reading this morning. You can see it in Exodus chapter 19. You can see this, that the whole mountain quakes. It says that the whole mountain was in a smoke. Now you're out there, you're one of those 2.5 millions, and you're looking at this, and the ground is shaking, and this is a mountain, and it's smoking. And God is saying, this is my glory. Do you see this? And what happens is amazing. Look at chapter 19 and verse 19, or 18. And now Mount Sinai was completely in smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire. Its smoke ascended to the smoke of a furnace. Of the whole mountain, it's quaking greatly. And when the blast of the trumpet sounded long and became louder, what Israelite is blowing the trumpet? It's not the Israelites. It's God. And there's a sound that's coming, and it's getting louder and louder. And Moses spoke, and God answered him by voice. And the Lord came down upon Mount Sinai on the top of the mountain. And the Lord called Moses to the top of the mountain. And Moses went up. That blows my mind. Are you kidding me? If God, this was happening, what are you doing? Anywhere but here, right? And God says to Moses, come on up. Okay, I'll do that. And that's what he does. And so he goes up into the mountain. The Lord said to Mount, look what happens here in verses 21 to 24. He says, go down, warn the people lest they break through to gaze at the Lord and many of them perish. Pause there, get this. There is an aspect about God where we can come into his presence and offend him. And God said to Moses, get away from here because these people are just going to come and look at me out of curiosity, and I don't accept that. You don't come to me in curiosity. You come to me in submission. And Moses said, and you look at the next verses, Moses said to him, oh God, don't worry about it. We put up fences, nobody's going to get there. And what does God say? Get away. Away with you. Why? Have you ever noticed that when you sit around a campfire, what's everybody doing? And there's a fire right in the middle, big blazing thing, and what is everybody doing? Why is that? There's an aspect of the fire that's constantly changing. It's something that just draws the attention. A thousandfold with God. There's this. Have you ever been in a situation where you know you need to kind of turn away, but you just can't? You got to keep looking? That's what's happening here. God says, get down there and keep them away from the mountain, because if they touch the mountain, I will slay them all. Okay, God, is this going a little bit too much? In our human mind, we think that, but not in God's mind, because of his holiness. So he says in verse 24, the Lord said to him, get away, get down. Then you come up with Aaron, but do not let the priests and the people break through to come to the Lord, lest he break out against them. And so what happens here, and I'm just going to tell you the story, we're going to go through this. All the people run back and say, okay, we're good with that. And what transpires? And in chapter 20, he gives them the Ten Commandments. Look at verse 18. After the Ten Commandments, God has spoken the Ten Commandments to the entire throng. Look what happens. In verse 18, now all the people witnessed the thundering and the lightning and the flashing and the sound of the trumpet and the moat and the mountain smoking, and the people saw it. They trembled and stood afar off. Smart people. 19, and then they said to Moses, you speak with us and we will hear, but let not God speak with us lest we die. That was the response of the people. They said, this God is so great. If we talk to him, we're going to die. So you talk to him, Moses. Moses said to the people, do not fear. Are you kidding me, Moses? I mean, if you turn around and looked at that mountain, do not fear. For God has come to test you that his fear may be before you so that you may not sin. So the people stood afar off. Moses drew near in the thick darkness where God was. Unbelievable happening there. And I believe at this moment, this is what sets the Israelites apart even to this day. This people met this God, and the descendants of these people are still on the earth thousands of years later. Nations have come and gone. They have been destroyed. God has returned them. Why? Because they're my people, he said. I want you to get the fact that it says there, he wants to put his fear inside of you so that you will not sin. The fear of God, the fear of God is the remedy to sin. Now, I mean fear of God. There is a trembling that's going on here, but I'm talking a reverential awe to this great God. Some of you that are sitting in here today are struggling with sin, and we're going to get to that. But you are struggling with sin either in your marriage or in job or in some sin that's overtaking you, and you can't get away from it. The answer to that is a reverential awe and fear of a holy God. It's actually love of this great God. But I want you to see what has just taken place here, where God has come down to the Garden of Eden. Now God has come down to this nation of Israel. In the Garden of Eden, they rebelled. So what's the response of the nation of Israel? In chapter 21 and chapter 22, and just turn your pages as I go through this, chapter 23 and chapter 24, all of these Moses is reciting later on. These are the words that God said to Moses. And so what happens is the people say, we can't talk to him. You go talk to him. Moses goes up and talks to him. And God gives him chapters 21 all the way up to 31. All right. He talks about the garments of the priesthood in chapter 28 and the altar of the burnt offering in 27. He talks about Aaron and his sons being consecrated in 29. In chapter 30, he talks about the incense, the altar of incense and ransom money and all of this stuff that he's talking to Moses about up in the mountain while the people are down on the ground, saying, where is Moses? And look at chapter 32. And I want you to get this, because this is what happens, and this is what's in your life, and this is what's in my life. Because after this great God comes down to this nation of Israel, What transpires, he says, this is who I am. Do you see how great I am? How glorious I am? What's their response? 40 days. 40 days. That's all. 40 days. That's a month and 10 days. How do they respond? Look at chapter 32. What do? Well, they have a feast where they're going to worship God. Right? That's true. Problem is, they make their own God. And it's called the golden calf. All these people say, we don't know where Moses is. He could have died. We don't know where he's at. So make us gods that took us out of Egypt. Are you kidding me? You got the choice between this golden calf and the guy that shakes that mountain and puts it in a smoke? And you're going to do this? So what happens? Aaron says in verse 2, break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters. Bring them to me. And he takes them off and he fashions it. And look what happens. I got you to see in verse 4. And he received the gold from their hand. He fashioned an engraving tool, made a golden calf. And then they said, this is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt. Wait a second. Who's the God that brought him out of Egypt? Yahweh, right? Lord God. They said, this is your God, O Israel. Now note what Aaron does in verse 5. And Aaron saw it. He built an altar before it. And Aaron made a proclamation and said, tomorrow is the feast to, what does your text say? You know what the Hebrew word is? Yahweh. And Aaron just messed up Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 and 2. Now, you're God. Let's just for a moment here. And you're in heaven, and you created this entire world. And this man just said, that golden calf is you. How do you feel about that? It's over. I'm going to destroy all of these people. That's what God feels, because you see that. Verse 6, and they rose up the next day and they offered burnt offerings to it. And look at what happens in verse 7. And the Lord said to Moses, go, get down, for your people whom you brought out of the land of Egypt have corrupted. And I'm going to do a study sometime with you of Exodus 32, 33, and 34, because they are that passage of Scripture is profound. I can't do that this morning. But there are about five rounds that goes back and forth with God. And God says, they're your people. And then Moses goes, no. Don't put them on me. They're your people. And Moses goes back and forth. And Moses wins the first round. Second round, God wins. And the third round, Moses wins. The fourth round, God wins. And the fifth round and the sixth round, which teaches you a lesson. Who's going to win in the end? God is. So you may win a round or two, but God's going to nail it by it's all over and then smile at you. But that's what happens in chapter 32. But I don't want you to miss this. Here is God coming to this nation and saying, I'll be your God. No other nation am I going to do this with. I will be your God. You will be my people. And in 40 days, what do? They turn away. They rebel. So God says, what? Why are you doing that? God shows his glory in the garden, and God shows his glory in Mount Sinai. Now, let's look at the next point. God shows his glory in Moses and tabernacle. And you can see that you're in 32. You can turn to 34. He has asked God to show himself. In chapter 33, he says, show me your glory, verse 18. And God openly shows himself in chapter 34. That's just a profound what happens there. He basically says to Moses, he said, if I let you see me, you will not exist anymore. The power and the glory of God is so pronounced and provocative that if we, with human eyes, were to see it, we would be blown out of existence. And God says, I can't let you see that, or you won't live. For no man can see God and live. So what transpires? God says, I'm going to pass by. You will see a reflection of my glory. That's what that word means there. In King James, it says, you'll see my back or back parts. That's just a word for reflection. In other words, I'm going to pass by, and what follows me, you'll see. And look what Moses' response in verse 8 of chapter 34. Moses made haste and what? Bowed his head toward the earth and worshiped. Now here's what I want you to see. There's coming a day where every man will do just what Moses did, Christian or not, believer or unbeliever. Because it says in Philippians chapter 2, and we'll look at this a little bit later in verse 10, every knee shall bow of heaven and on heaven, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. That's going to happen in the future. And my face at that point will be on the ground before my God. But God says, okay, I'm going to show my glory to this people again. And how does he do that? He shows this in the glory of Moses in the tabernacle. Because in chapter 34, look, I want you to see in verse 35, look what happens. Moses is up talking to God and making amends for this nation. Thank God for Moses. If it hadn't been for Moses, there wouldn't have been Israel around today. And he makes amends. He tells, please forgive. Remember your people. God is merciful. But something happens that we're also talked about in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Paul recites this a little bit later. We'll look at that. But what has transpired, and I want you to, brothers and sisters, listen to me. This is what happens. Moses is up talking to God. And because he's talking with God, and he can't see him face to face, but he's talking with God, because that transpires, he comes down the mountain, then he meets all of the Israelites, and he says to them, I want to tell you who this great God is. And they're running the opposite direction. What in the world? Why? Because what does it say in verse 35? It says, and Moses, and whenever the children of Israel saw the face of Moses, the skin of Moses' face shone. You know what happened? Because he was talking to this almighty God, this glorious God, when he came down, his face was like a light bulb. Now, if I was preaching here and all of a sudden my face started to get a little bit brighter and brighter and brighter, and all of a sudden it was really shining like a light bulb, where would you be? Out that door or that door or this door? You said, no, I'll be godly. I'll watch this happen. You would not. Something's wrong with the pastor, all right? And you're running to the hills. That's what happens to Moses. And they're going, we can't handle this. And Moses, it says in the scripture, doesn't even know his face is shining. But you know what he's saying to them? Listen to me. This is what he is saying to them. He says, you see this face? You see this face? This is your representation of your God. What do you mean? I am simply showing to you a reflection of God's reflection of his glory. So this is three steps apart from. That's how powerful your God is. And because he wasn't talking with God, the glory would diminish, and he would put a cover over his face, a veil, so that they couldn't see that it diminished. And he'd run back up to a God and start talking to God again. He'd come back down. He'd show, see this? This is your God. This is your God. Before it diminished, he'd put it over. Paul deals with that in 2 Corinthians 3, and we'll look at that. But what's their response to that? What is their response to that? Well, it's not just Moses. It's Moses and the tabernacle. God openly reveals himself in the face of Moses, and he openly reveals himself in the tabernacle. You're in chapter 35. Turn to chapter 40 of Exodus. In verses 34 and 35, and look what happens. And so they build this tabernacle that God says, I want built for me. And so they build the entire tabernacle. It takes them months to do this. And then what happens? When the cloud covered the tabernacle of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle, and Moses was not even able to enter the tabernacle of meeting because the cloud rested above it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. So here you've got God just not on the mountain. He is right in the middle of them. And it's so powerful that Moses can't even walk in. Keep your finger here if you want to turn for verification. You can see it back. What happens at this? Hebrews chapter 3. If not, I'll just read it to you. Hebrews chapter 3. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today if you will hear His voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. What? In the day of trial in the wilderness when your fathers tested me and tried me, and they saw my work 40 years. Therefore, I was angry with that generation and said, they always are astray in their hearts. They have not known my way, so I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Did you get that? God makes a statement that these people who saw my glory and turned away from it and rebelled will not enter my rest. 2.5 million people. And then he says this, beware, beloved, brethren, lest there be any of you in any of you an evil heart and unbelief in departing from the living God, and exhort one another daily while it is today, lest any of you harden through the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. And they failed. Verse 16, for who, having heard, rebelled? Indeed, was it not all who came out of Egypt led by Moses? Now with whom was he angry for 40 years? Was it not those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey? Brothers and sisters, that's our admonition this morning. You have heard the word of God. God has shown you who He is. You come here and you hear the word of God. And then we walk away and rebel against God. And we do the exact same thing. Now listen to me carefully. I love you dearly. You are in my heart, but listen to me. If you are giving yourself over to sin, if there is something in your heart right now that the Holy Spirit is grieved with in your life, you are doing exactly what the Israelites did in the Old Testament. We saw the glory of God and we're going to go our own way. Oh, Pastor, I would never bow down in front of a golden calf. Would you do it in front of a car? Would you do it in front of a computer screen? Would you do it in front of a person? Would you do it in front of money? Would you do it in front of your own pride? Because somebody has said something about you and offended you and you're bothered and it's ticking you off, and I don't like that and I'm not going to respond right according to what the Scripture tells me. It's the same stuff, folks. There's no difference. When you and I have been given by the grace of God the chance to read this book and to understand it, you and I have, we can come here, we can hear a sermon on the Word of God, we can understand the glory of God. There are people that I have seen in the last month who don't have that daily privilege. They don't understand the Word of God. They don't have the Word of God. And we sit here and do it, and our response, when the devil comes and says, hey, I got some good stuff for you, what do? We do exactly what the Israelites did, and we walk away, and we say, are you kidding me? The glory of this earth is greater than the glory of our God? You see, every time my soul sins against God, I am choosing an idol, a golden calf, before my God. Because He says to me, well, don't do that. So I'll do what I want to do. See what I'm saying? And you know what happens then? The glory of God departs. So God comes to Israel, the Garden of Eden, or to mankind, the Garden of Eden, comes to Israel down in Egypt. He shows His glory in the tabernacle. He shows His glory in the face of Moses. He shows His glory at Mount Sinai. He doesn't end there. He's not done with this nation. Because the next one is the glory of the temple. You can turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and see what transpires there. Now, that might be a difficult passage for you to look at. Or to find, I guess I should say. In my book, it's 385. So if you got the same Bible as I got, just look around 385, okay? 2 Chronicles. There's two Chronicles in the Old Testament. But 2 Chronicles, chapter 7. There was a man by the name of David who loved, I love David. I just really love David. I love his heart. I love his, un,
I mean, that guy is willing to, I mean, when he's worshiping his God, get out of the way, okay? He loves God so much. And so he says, God, I'm going to build you a temple. And God says, no, you're not. Your son's going to do it. Yeah. All right? So what does David do? He says, okay, I can't build it, but I can sure provide for it. And he just unloads. Why? Because he has his love for who God is. I love that about him. And so his son, Solomon, is born. He becomes the smartest man because God has a, you know that story. He has, you know, what do you want? He says, I want wisdom. And God says, okay, you got wisdom. And so now he's the smartest man total. And he builds the house of God. It's called the temple. Took 7 years to build, 150,000 laborers to build this building. God used gold and silver and gems without number. I mean, the entire inside of this building is gold. The ceiling isn't like that. It's gold plated. The walls are gold. So you strike a match, one match, guess what happens? Whew, the whole place is lit up. I mean, this is an unbelievable wonder of the world. So they spend all of this money and they do all of this work. Look what happens in chapter 7. Verse 1, when Solomon had finished praying, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offerings and the sacrifices. 30,000, by the way, bulls. 120,000 lambs are sacrificed. I can't get my head around all that. Just trying to do that. And the priests could not enter the house of the Lord, verse 2, because the glory of the Lord filled the house of the Lord. And all the children of Israel saw how the fire came down and the glory of the Lord in the temple. And they bowed their faces to the ground on the pavement and worshiped and praised the Lord, saying, He is good. His mercy endures forever. Brother and sister, when you come here in the morning, that needs to be your heart. Oh, but my heart aches this morning because you know what? We get so caught up with the world throughout the week and we get here and God says, worship me. And we're thinking about all the crud of the week that we've just gone through. And we have the opportunity to shelve all that stuff and say, forget it. What matters is I've got a great God and I'm going to worship Him this morning. Amen? Amen? So what transpires here, and it's going to happen again in the future, is these people worship the Lord their God. Verse 4, and the king and all the people offered sacrifices before the Lord. King Solomon offered sacrifices of 22,000 bulls, give or take 1,000 there. 22,000 bulls and 120,000 sheep. And the king and the people dedicated the house of the Lord. And the priests attended to their services. And the Levites also were instruments. And they brought in music, which King David had made to praise the Lord, saying, For His mercy endures forever. Whenever David offered praise by their ministry, the priests sounded the trumpet opposite to them, where the Israel stood. Furthermore, Solomon consecrated the middle of the court that was in front of the house of the Lord, and there he offered burnt offerings also. But all of this stuff that happens is that God is showing His glory, and He is saying to these people, Do you see who I am? I will come down among you. I will be to you your God. You will be my people. But they had the same struggle that we have. The devil offers other stuff. And the devil offers other stuff to you. If you'll just turn away from your God, you won't believe the good stuff I'll give you, he says. So what happens? And this is I don't have time to go into this, but this is a very unusual happening. And you can finally just write it in your notes, Ezekiel 8 and 9. There's a story there that I wish I could go through, but Ezekiel 8 and 9 tells the story of the glory of God leaving the temple. And Ezekiel is given the vision of where God says, This was my house. This was my place. They built it for me, and now look what they're doing. And it talks about all of the idols that they brought into the temple. Into the temple. And they're worshiping other gods in the temple. And God says, My glory's gone. I'm out of here. I'm not going to deal with this. God says, I've tried to show in the Garden of Eden my glory. I've tried to show
through Moses my glory. I've tried to show in the tabernacle my glory. I've tried to show at Mount Sinai my temple, my glory. I've tried to show in the temple my glory. And what does everybody do? They rebel and walk away. So I'll put the creation out there. They rebel. Okay? God says, put it in Moses and they rebel. Put it in the temple, they rebel. You know what I'll do? I'll send my son. I'll turn to the New Testament, John chapter 1. Because the letter E here is the glory of Jesus Christ. John chapter 1. Beautiful statement is made about our great God. Chapter 1 and verse 14 of John says, And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So God says, you know what? Okay, I showed my glory in light with Moses, and I showed my glory in the temple, and I showed my glory in the garden, and they've rejected all of those. I'm going to bring my Son, and my Son is going to show in human flesh the glory of my name. And here John says, you know what? We saw Him. He was full of glory. But look at verse 11. He came into His own and what? Brothers and sisters, it didn't say He came unto strangers. What did it say? He came into His own. And what did they do? Rejected Him. Are you kidding me? Listen. Is there, what about Jesus? Tell me something negative about Jesus. Tell me some complaint. There is none. He was a perfect man. He was God Almighty. And what was the response of human beings to this God who has never sinned, who displayed love and joy and told the truth? What did they do? We don't accept You. And they crucified Him. And all the way through human history, God has shown His glory to mankind, and man has rebelled or rejected it. And that's the glory of God yesterday. Now I want to take you to the glory of God tomorrow. Glory of God tomorrow. Okay? Not a very good story, this glory that God has shown us in the past. We have really not done very well, right? Okay, so what about the glory of God in the future? What about the glory of God tomorrow? And I want to just show you a couple things. The glory of the second coming. You guys know what that is? All right, now you may be pre-mill, post-mill, a-mill, all of those eschatological positions. All right, everybody believes Jesus is coming back. Right? Whether you believe it's going to be in a rapture, and He's going to... He's coming back. We're not here, right? That's the big glory and delight of the Lord. Amen? Amen? Amen. So Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back, all right? So what's the glory of the second coming? God openly reveals Himself out of total darkness. You're in John, so turn up three books to the left in Matthew chapter 24. And I want you to just see how this is going to happen, how this is going to go down. In Matthew 24, now this is the glory of God in the future. Verse 29, Matthew 24, 29, it's the coming of the Son of Man. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will darken and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from heaven and the powers of heaven will be shaken. Has that happened ever in the history of mankind? You got stars falling in on it? No, you don't, right? The powers of the heaven will be shaken. Then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven. And then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great. Let me just kind of set this up. What's going to happen in the future when Jesus comes is God's going to knock out all the lights. No sun, no moon, no stars, absolute darkness in the heavens. And then guess what? Jesus. I'm going to be so... Now, according to your theology, you're either coming with Him or you're down here on earth, okay? Either way, it don't matter. Jesus is coming, right? God turns out all the lights And then Jesus comes back and it shows the glory of our great God. And I believe, according to the scriptures, that we'll be with him. In fact, you can find that in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 4, where it says, we will be with him. All right? Now, you sense that. The sun went away, total darkness, right? Moon goes away, no stars, no light, and Jesus comes back. Now, let's say you don't believe in Jesus. What comes into your head at that point? I'm in trouble, right? God says, I will reveal him, and I will tell you this, which I delight. Look at chapter 25 and verse 31. And when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of glory and all nations will be gathered before him and they will rebel against him. So it says, and they will not deny. No, it says, and he will separate them one from another. Shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will set up the sheep on his right hand and the goats on his left hand. And the king will say to those on his right hand, come, you blessed of the Lord, inherit the kingdom that I prepared for you from the foundation of the world, for I was hungry. And he goes on from there. But I'm going to tell you right now that those people who say, we're not going to follow you, God's got a plan for them in 45 and 46. And what I'm saying to you is that there is going to be judgment at that day. And that judgment is going to go across the world. This is in the future. In the future, when Jesus Christ comes, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. There will be no denial of his glory. They will bow down. They may do so in a lack of subordination in their heart. They may not want to, but the very power of our God will demand they bow down and they will confess, he is Lord. I will not submit to him, but he is Lord. And God says, fine, you go to hell. There will be no rebellion. So what's eternity going to be like? Because, you know, we're talking about the past. We're not talking about today. We'll get to that. We're talking about the future. Jesus is going to come back. He's going to show his glory, right? Everybody's going to admit that he is King and Lord. But what's going to happen in eternity? What's that going to be like? There's a book that deals with that. You know what that book's name is? Take a guess. Starts with an R, ends with an N, and it's the last book of the Bible. It's Revelation. Let's turn there. I want you to see a couple of passages of Scripture. Look at Revelation chapter 21, last book of the Bible, second to last chapter of this book. Chapter 21, verse 11. Talking about the New Jerusalem. And he carried me away, verse 10, into the Spirit in a great and high mountain and showed me the great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God. Her light was like the most precious stone, like the jasper stone, clear as crystal. Talks about the gates that were there. And you have a... You okay, bud? I don't want you to go to heaven right now, okay? So drink up the coffee or whatever that is in there, okay? But what I'm saying is it's having the glory of God, and her light was like unto a stone, most precious, even like the jasper stone, clear as crystal. Look at verse 23. For the glory, chapter 21 and verse 23, the city had no need of the sun or the moon to shine for it, for the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is its light. Can you get that? Do you see that? There's no sun, there's no moon, there's light all around. Why? Because of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen? And it's exploding in light. This is what's in the future for the glory of God. In chapter 22, in verse 4, this has nothing to do with the sermon, it's just a great verse. And I've got it in my notes. Look at that. Look at verse 22:4. and they will see His face. And His name will be on their forehead. And there will be no night there. They need no lamp, nor light of sun, for the Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. That's our future. That's the glory of God for us in the future. And they will see His face. Nothing greater in all of the Scripture than that phrase. And they will see His face. Now, we can talk about the glory of God in the yesterdays and be sad because of the rebellion. We can look at the glory of God in the future and just be absolutely ecstatic. But what about the glory of God today? The glory of God today. Well, let me simply say the glory is not in a building. Okay? The glory of God is not in a building. The glory abides in Christians. And I so want this to be in your heart. Glory of God is in Christians, is in believers. In Colossians chapter 1 and verse 27, listen to these words. To them God willed to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles. Listen to this. Which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Listen to me. Listen to me. Gird up your minds and listen to me. When you became a Christian, when God changed your heart, He regenerated your soul. When that took place, God deposited within your soul the Holy Spirit, and He is the seal of your inheritance, and no one and nothing can take Him away. This is your God. And this great God that was on Mount Sinai, that shook the mountain, lives within your soul. This great God who created all that you see and the stars of the heaven and the sun and the moon and this earth and rotates it and holds it all and speaks the name of the stars. He resides within your soul. So when you come against all those trials and tribulations and struggles, you're not alone. This great God resides within and dwells within you. And listen to me, listen to me. There is nothing greater than this God in your soul. Nothing. You will not come up against anything that's greater than that. You will not come up against a trial that's greater than that. There will be no sorrow that's greater than that. You could lose your entire family, and it's still greater that the Son of God in Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit resides within your soul. And this world has nothing to compare to that. The glory of God resides or abides in believers. It's within the soul. And you're in Colossians, turn to the left to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And we will get to this in the future, God willing, if He gives me life on this earth. But in chapter 3 of 2 Corinthians, you have this study starting in verse 7 and beyond, where it talks about Moses' face coming down, shining like a lamp. And then he says in verse 18, which is my favorite verse in the Bible, but we all with open face, beholding as in a mirror or as in a glass, the glory of the Lord. Do you get this? God is saying right now, you and I have the opportunity to see the glory of God in the Word of God with the Holy Spirit within our soul. But we all with open face beholding as in a glass the glory are what? What does it say? We are what? We are changed. We are transformed. That word there is metamorphosis. Just like a butterfly. God comes in and starts to transform. And the problem that we have, beloved, is that we're not looking at Jesus, as according to Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2. We're not looking to Jesus. We're looking at the stuff of this world. And the world comes to you and says, you know what? Hey, take this. All you have to do is give up a little bit of Christianity. And here, have this. And you just turn away from Christianity. It's the exact same thing that's been going on since the Garden of Eden. And we're listening to it and we're buying into it. And we buy in because of money or prestige or power or friendship. I'm offended by what you said to me. Really? Really? You're going to let that bother you when you've got a great God that says, come to me, love me, and I will live with you and be with you? See that? Now listen to me, what I'm saying here. Don't let the evil one make it concentrate on something else. Listen to what I'm saying. We're talking about this great God who resides within your heart. And the devil, every single day of your life from here to where you go home to be with him, every single day the devil is going to tempt you to give up something that God has for you for something greater on this earth. And we tend to be people of sight. And instead of believing out of faith, we go to this and we look at this and say, this is important. I can see this. I can't see God. Can you show me God right now? No. But I know he's within my heart. So the devil says, well, I'll give you something that you can see and you can have. All you got to do is turn away from the Lord. And that's your call every single day. And the reason my heart is so exercised on this topic is because what has transpired is in this church, God has been here. God has shown himself in this place. But my heart is convicted. Because if you want to know that God is within a place, you will see God changing the life of people in that place. And we weep and pray over individuals that have sat in these chairs not knowing who God is. And we beg God to save, and it's not saving. Now, for those of you that are visiting, we talk turkey here in this. And I want you to listen to what my heart is on this. Why? I told you this when we started this church. Where are the salvations? When's the last time we saw God just come in and just ravage a person's heart and bring them to? On most Sundays, we have unsaved people sitting in the pews. You know what I yearn for? That those people can't walk out without wanting Jesus. But you know what transpires in any church? You know what we have to fight? We have to fight sin. Why? Because the Spirit of God comes here, and the Spirit of God is sensitive. And if we have a congregation of people that have said no to God for whatever reason, or we said stuff that we shouldn't say to other people, or we have conflicts with other people, and we're not dealing with those things, you know what? The Holy Spirit just says, you know what? I'll back away right here. Beloved, listen to me carefully. If the Holy Spirit is banging on your heart saying, you got to get that right. You got to change that. I'm telling you right now, you're influencing this place. What? Yeah. Some of you know what it's like to be in a place where the Spirit of God is just pervasive and everything has happened, and all of a sudden a person walks in and you go, whoa, what was that? When we were working and ministering up in Ohio, we had people come to our church who knew nothing about who God was, and they brought with them all of the crud of this world. And if you don't think that evil ones attach themselves to the sinful lifestyles of people, you're wrong. If he's got Christians here who are saying no to the Holy Spirit within and he is grieved, Holy Spirit's not moving in your life. And that pervades other people all around you. You may be the reason. You may be the reason God's withholding the salvations. That's pretty blunt, Pastor. I may be the reason that God is withholding. The question that I have for you today is, are you willing today to say, God, I want to know your glory. I want to sense your presence in my life. As I wept here yesterday, worshiping the Lord in this place, because we want God here. I'm only responsible for my soul. But you can come here in rebellion to God And it affects the whole atmosphere around us. And where people are weeping for the souls of an individual to come to know Jesus, you're stopping that. Say, where in the world, Pastor, do you get that? You ever heard about the grieving of the Holy Spirit and offending the Holy Spirit? If you're here today and you know you're doing stuff or allowing stuff in your life that is against the Spirit of God, you're affecting this room with evil. And we will never see God's Spirit move unless God comes in and changes your heart. And it all comes with one word, repentance. You say, Pastor, I'm not perfect. We're in the same boat. What is God saying to you right now? Saying, get rid of it. Repent of it. What is it? Is it your pride? Is it your want of power? What is it? What selfishness? Guys, are you letting your eyes see stuff that you shouldn't be seeing? Ladies, too? We're not here for that. We're here to see an almighty God. And I'm calling you today into account and say, come clean with God. Stop it. If you don't know Jesus today, I'm begging you to come know who the Lord God is. But I want you to deal with business today, because you've got a glorious God who's been banging on your heart saying, confess your sins unto me. Repent of your sins, and I will fill your life with myself. You're making the same decision today Israelites and Moses made. I beg you to be a Moses and say, I want the face of God. Let's bow our heads. We're going to hold off with your heads bowed and your eyes closed. I want you to do business with God right now. And that's going to take you into His presence. Face Him. Talk to Him. I'm going to ask Ron and Carrie if you'll come here. You guys can stand right over there. And if you need to, we're gonna linger here. And if you need to pray with somebody, I want you to come and pray with these. Maria is here. Stop playing games. Stop allowing sin. And ask God to cleanse you. Come on, folks. Are you really serious with God that you want Him in your life? I'm asking for you who are needing prayer. Come up and talk with one of us up here. That's right. Are you willing to give it up today? So that you can enjoy the glory of God? Children, have you been obedient to your parents? Do you need to deal with this great God today? whoever you are and wherever you are, repent of those things that are keeping you from enjoying the grace of God. Greg, come on up. Let's have a new beginning as far as this church is concerned. I'm not a big one on show and all of this, but if you need someone to pray with, stop playing games and come meet your God and pray with the people that are up here. Is everything okay? Come on, folks. Give it up and follow the Lord. Teens, if you need to talk with someone, Brant will be here in just a second to pray with you. But just make that commitment. Say, God, I'm done with this sin. I'm giving it up. I don't want it in my life anymore. God, hear our prayers today. We want your glory here. We want your majesty here. We want your wonder in our hearts. God, humble us. Humble us. Humble me. That we may bow in your presence and live for you and love you and forget all this stuff of this world. God, please move in our hearts today. Place your glory before your people. Come, Holy Spirit. Father, I commend these hearts to you. I ask you to crack us wide open. I ask you to help us to deal with our sin and our unwillingness to bow before your cross. God, I pray for the teenagers that are here today. They know they're not walking with you. They know it. Give them the boldness, God. Change their heart. That they may come unto you and say, be my God. Help the dad that was here today that's struggling with his relationship with his wife and with his children. God, give him the sense that if he will just come to you and commend it all to you, you'll take care of it. I don't know how it will turn out. Yes, he'll walk with you. Help that dad who's right now struggling and keeping his life pure and holy before you, God. Draw these men to the place of holiness. God, work in their souls so they become men of prayer and men willing to get up in the morning and pray. Pray for those wives that are here that are in difficult situations because their husbands are not following you. God, give them strength and help them to remember that you know exactly what they're going through and that they are not alone. I pray for our single ladies here. God, encourage them, strengthen them. May they know that there has never been a day where you have left them. for those who are struggling through financial difficulties. Lord, help them to give it up to you. Say, you're in control. Draw us as a church, God. Draw us as a church to you, to bow before you and say, you are our God and we will serve no other. Cleanse our lives. And Father, walk with us today and teach us who you are, that we may live before you. Heal the sick. Heal the lame. Raise them up. And let this be a place where people can come and find rest and strength and hope. And as you do all of these things, we will give you praise and lift our hearts before you. For we pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen. Thank you, guys. Let's all stand. We're going to sing one final song. If you have spiritual needs that you need to be taken care of, I'm going to ask you to deal with those today. Don't play games. Don't turn around. Don't shove it for another day. Deal with that stuff and come before a holy God. Say, God, I just want to love you. I just want to serve you. So let's sing one final song. Crown him with many crowns and sing it with your hearts.